Oh, we are live now. Welcome all to the Indo-Bangla sports meeting. And this time the theme is knee sports injury. Let's discuss. And thanks to Biotech, Team Biotech, for organizing this wonderful meeting. We have faculty from Bangladesh, Dhaka and Chittagong. Professor Dr. Hassan Masood from Bangladesh, Dr. Muhammad Abdul Hai from Chittagong, and Dr. Chaudhary Iqbal Mahmood from Dhaka. And we have Indian faculty, when a senior arthroscopy surgeon, Dr. Clement Joseph, sir. Thanks, sir, for making time from your busy schedule. Dr. Yugal Vardhani from Chennai and Dr. Sridhar Gangarupu from Vizag. And it's a almost real live video session, but we will have some lectures also and discussion also. And we will have question at the end of the session. And we will take some question from the chat box and some question from the YouTube channel also. So we will start this meeting right now, and the first talk will be by Dr. Sridhar only, and he will be talking on hamstring graft harvesting technique in ACL reconstruction. Welcome, Dr. Sridhar.
Thanks.
Yes.
Good evening, everyone. So I thank Team Biotech and Dr. Rajiv Hamansar for giving me this opportunity. So I hope it will be an academic piece tonight. So I will be talking on hamstring graft harvesting technique in ACL reconstruction. There are a lot of debates going on regarding DPT or a hamstring graft, which is better, or the recent ones, whether a quadriceps or a peroneus. So many other graft options for ACL reconstruction. So I'm not going in detail in those things, only just concentrating on the hamstring graft, what is the technique of harvesting the hamstring graft, semitendinosus and great release, especially what are the tips and tricks we have to follow and what will be the consequences if it is not followed. So I'll be just running through a few slides and giving a short video of the procedure. So regarding the position, so if you're doing a ACL reconstruction for both for the procedure and for the graft harvesting, it is always better to have a very comfortable position and the best position for our surgery. Either we have two options, either we can break the table and leave it hanging on the table side, and always make sure that you can able to comfort, flex it up to 120, 130 degrees. And always keep your tourniquet very high so that if you pass your tendon slipper, it will be passed into the thigh comfortably, and you could make out the direction of the tendon slipper. And also later for the surgery, the deep pins will be comfortably manipulated. And other option is either you can keep the patient straight onto the table with the T-chair position, leg flex 90 degrees. In this position, either you can keep it in figure of four position during the harvesting, whatever you are comfortable with. The surface marking is to mark the patellar tendon and the tibial tuberosity. So on either side, the anteromedial and anterolateral portal and incision. So regarding the skin incision, we have three options. Most of the people, they follow vertical incision, some may follow horizontal incision, and some people may be comfortable with the oblique incision. But why we are so much worried about the skin incisions of these three options is because of the nerve injury. So everyone is more concerned about the nerve injury. The infrapatellar branch of the saphenous nerve and the sartorial branch of the saphenous nerve, these two branches are more related in the vicinity of our surgical field. Among these two sartorial branch and the infrapatellar branch, the infrapatellar branch is very close to the incision, especially when you're doing a vertical incision. So studies have showed that the chances of nerve injury is very much less when you are going for an oblique incision. Because in a vertical incision, if you are going down to the bone, there is a high chance of cutting the nerve, especially in the vertical incision. Oblique incision, if you are going in a one plane, you can at least bypass the nerve so that it can be salvaged. So skin incision is very much important when you are caring about this nerve injury. And also the picture here, it shows that the nerve supply of the infrapatellar branch and the sartorial branch. So if at all the infrapatellar branch is injured, patient may complain of hyposthesia in the infrapatellar region on the medial aspect. So just surgical technique. Just one minute. I'll be sharing the video. So this is the video. So this is the video where we are initially we do the surface marking in patella and the patella ligament and the tibial tuberosity, medial and lateral joint line. That's the tibial tuberosity. And medially, we palpate the medial border of the chin of the tibia. So tibial medial side, we palpate, and the tibial tuberosity, we almost go midway between these two identification marks. So that usually our transit tendons will be coming from the thigh in that direction. So usually we are halfway between the tibial tuberosity and the medial border, and 2 centimeters medial and 2 centimeters below the tibial tuberosity. But always we have to make sure it is not a what you call as a dictum that every patient will have in the same anatomical landmark. It may vary depending on the patients and if it is a thin or thick patient or obese patient. So sometimes there can be anomalies, the tendons can be a little bit higher or less. So here it's a vertical incision, we are taking through that. And the main tip is always knife should be only into the skin. So only skin incision is done with the knife. After the skin, we even subcutaneous plane, we have to go only with a blunt incision. So never go with the knife beneath the skin. So once the skin incision is done, so elevate the with a periosteum elevator, blunt dissection, or with a finger. So once you do a soft tissue dissection, we can see that white glistening structure, so tendons beneath that. So we can just roll our finger and then we can palpate that actually the both gracilis and the semitendinous tendons rolling beneath our finger. So this is where we can see that. So with tablet, we are just trying to make out that board. So just leave it there. Separate plane. So the tendon, you will be seeing the sartorial fascia. The sartorial fascia just measures over these two tendons and gets attached to the anterior medial border of the tibial shin. So we try to elevate that, and usually the inverted L-shaped incision is the one which is given in the book. So, but whatever you are comfortable. So the superior incision is along the superior border of the gracilis tendon. The gracilis tendon is the one which is superior or proximal, and the semitendinosus is beneath that. So once the superior border of the gracilis is identified and opened up, you can give a L-shaped, inverted L-shaped incision along the medial border. So once you open up the sartorial fascia, where we are holding here, it's a sartorial fascia, and this has the tendon beneath that. So the white glistening structure inside will be the medial collateral ligament. Always make sure that you see the medial collateral ligament and don't misinterpret about the tendons and the medial collateral ligament. So once you hook it with the right angle, you can bring out the tendons here and isolate them. Either we can use a vicryl or an Ethibond or some any other material or band to isolate them. So one tendon is isolated, try to pull it out. So once it is pulled out, we are more confirmed that it is a tendon, not any facial sheath or any medial collateral ligament band. So once we identify the gracilis, so beneath that will be a semitendinosus tendon, which is much thicker than that and larger than the gracilis one. So identify that, and once you pull it out, you can isolate both the tendons separately. So here you can see that there are much facial bands or adhesions between these two, which you can separate it with the curved scissors, and always make sure the scissors is pointed down, not into the proximal side, because the tendons are going in a proximal direction. So that is the direction of the tendon attachment. So it is a less chance that if you are directing your scissors down, so chances of cutting down the tendons are premature. So once you detach the tendon, either you can do a stitch and to the edge of the tendon for holding it out. Some people hold it with a artery and just pull it out. Some people just put a like knot and fix it. Some people do a stitch. So whatever you are comfortable in your technique, you can do that. And once you stitch the distal end, you pass, the main thing is you pass your finger 360 degrees around the tendon. So initially, don't be in a hurry to pulling out the tendon. don't be in a hurry to cut it out the tendon. So all, don't be in a hurry to pass your tendon strip for taking out the tendon. So initially, spend much time, especially for the juniors, if you are in a starter of the arthroscopic ACL reconstruction, spend much time in isolating the tendon, keeping your fingers around the tendon, and try to stretch it. If the tendon is able to stretch it up to tibial tuberosity or below behind that, so it is much confirmed that it is not a facial shear or any other fracture. It's 100% confirmed that you are isolating only tendon. So once you take out the tendon, so you can pass with a tendon stripper, and the main thing is you should be able to comfortably pass the stripper without any force. So you should not force the tendon. So if you do force it, it happens like this inside and may cause a premature cutting of the graft. So always try to pass it in its direction or free direction, and in the same time you put a tension over the tendon. So once the stripper goes easily, you can easily harvest the tendon. That's the tendon which we can pull it out. So once we take out the slip, so the next extremity you can do in the similar way, pass your finger all around the tendon 360 degrees, and mostly almost around 10 to 12 centimeters inside, you can feel a band which is going down and attached to the medial head of gas minus. That's the most common band we encounter, that one. So always see for that and look for that or feel for that, and make sure that you release that band to the from the tendon, and once again you stitch that edges and try to pull it out. So you're able to pull it more than 10 to 12 centimeters outside and almost close to the tibial tuberosity. So that makes sure that it is a tendon. So once it is done again, you try to release all the bands inside up to the fossa. So once it is done, again, repeat the same procedure using the finger. And if you are comfortably able to pass your finger around the tendon, so you are sure enough that there is no more adhesion. So now again, pass the tendon stripper. Go inside that. And always make sure that stripper goes in very easily. You should not force the stripper inside. So once it goes in easily, the tendon comes out. So that's the tendon we got it out. Thank you.
Thank you, Sridhar. And we will have question at the end of the session only.
Yes.
I think we will have next talk by Dr. Chaudhary Iqbal Mahmood on peroneus tendon graft. Please unmute yourself, Dr. Iqbal.
Yeah,
all right, yeah.
Yeah, okay. Am I audible now?
You are audible, the slides are visible.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you very much for inviting me for this Indo-Bangla session. I'm going to discuss about the technique of peroneus longus harvesting in ACLR. Recently, this tendon is becoming very popular, particularly in Asian countries, even in our country, but although it is not commonly used in the Western countries. So I will be talking about the technique and also some literature information regarding its donor cell morbidity and its functional outcome. This is the hospital, Bangabandhu Sheikh Mujib Medical University. I work as an associate professor. I also work privately in Green Life in a knee center. So ACL reconstruction is the current gold standard for restoring knee stability. It requires either an autograft, allograft, or artificial graft. Hamstring tendon autograft is the most popular graft. Other autografts include bone patella, bone tendon, and cordyceps tendon. No globally accepted gold standard of graft choice exists in use for use in ACLR. Recently, a peroneus longus autograft has explored as an alternative autograft for ACL reconstruction. First PLT autograft was used by Turkish group Kerimoglu in 2008. The ideal graft should be capable of withstanding. It should be strong enough to withstand translation and rotational stresses of the knee, allow for ingrowth in the bone tunnels, limit donor side morbidity, easy to harvest and technically reproducible tick. So minimizing donor cell morbidity is an important factor for graft selection. But I don't think till date there is no ideal graft. So there are multiple graft options, autograft, which includes BTBT, TB, hamstring, quadriceps, parens longa, allograft, and synthetic graft. The most popular graft is hamstring graft in the world, but there are some disadvantages regarding hamstring. It's a soft tissue to bone healing, so it takes a longer time. There may be a tunnel widening and loss of hamstring strength, donor side morbid, which includes paresthesia and unpredictable graft diameter. There is another concern regarding hamstring is that in our country or in even Asian country, the graft diameter is even after quadruple strands, so you will get hardly 7 or 7.5 millimeter. And in the literature, it shows that graft diameter less than 8 millimeter is risk factor for axial graft rupture. So this is one reason we will look for alternative graft. A little bit about the anatomy of the parens longa tendon. It is originated from the head of the fibula, upper one-third, two-third lateral fibular shaft surface, inserted in the plantar posterior lateral expert, the medial cuneiform, and lateral side of the first metatarsal bone. Action inverts the foot and plantar flexes the ankle, particularly the great toe, and also support the transverse of the foot, innervated by superficial peroneal nerve and arterial supply and rotatable peroneal arteries. What are the some biomechanical properties? The literature shows that it has got the adequate tensile strength to comparison to hamstring tendon, so it could be used as a graft for ACLR. There is no significant difference between hamstring strength and the PLT strength. You can see, and it's PLT. It ultimate tensile strength is almost 2,122 to 2,483 newton, and average graft length is 29 centimeter. So regarding the graft, the tensile strength, it can be used as a safe and effective alternative for ACLR. And also it can be, the graft diameter can be predicted in case of parens longus tendon, which is related to height, weight, and duration of injury. So indication for PLT could be multi-ligament reconstruction, revision ACLR, PCLR, augmentation in case of replacement option in inadequate ST graft, or during graft, if there is any graft amputation or thin or short graft, or as a primary graft for ACLR in case of short stocky females, or if there is medial side injury. Now the techniques of parens longus harvesting. The position is supine after scrubbing and draping. You have to mark some bony landmarks like this lateral malleus, tip of the lateral malleus, and the fibular head, and another line horizontally about 5 centimeters below the fibular head to give you a sense that you don't push up enough to injure the peroneal nerve. So after marking, start the incision just 1 centimeter behind and 2 centimeter proximal to the lateral malleolus. Through the skin and subcutaneous section, they go bluntly up to the superficial perineal retinal column to avoid injury to the sural nerve. Here you can see this making incision through the skin and subcutaneous tissue and bluntly go up to the superficial perineal retinal column. After that, it can be easily seen the parens longus tendon, which is superficial to parens brevis tendon, and parens longus tendon is tendineous, and distal part is tendineous than the parens brevis tendon. It can be easily recognized, and it can easily retrieve through the wound. And after that, after retrieving through the wound, you can tie both the tendon with non-absorbable suture. You can retrieve the tendon through a curve like Monihan's clamp. You can tie both the tendon so that you can clearly identify the both tendon, penis longus and penis brevis. Here you can see the both tendons are tied to the bundle tab suture. After tying both the suture, you have to cut the penis longus tendon. And sorry, after tying, you have to tie the suture, the penis longus tendon to the penis brevis tenodesis, so that it will keep some function of the penis longus tendon. Two or three suture, you tie penis longus to penis brevis tendon. After that, cut the penis longus tendon just proximal to the suture and keep the ankle diverted so that you can get more length. After that, just put a finger and remove the some adhesions around the penis longus tendon. After cutting the penis longus tendon, you have to put the tendon stripper through the suture and keep a mild gentle tension and push the stripper along the underneath the skin, and not to push in the upper part of the leg because it can injure the peroneal nerve. So it's not that difficult technique, it's easy technique, but you have to be careful not to injure the sural nerve or common peroneal nerve. After that, take the tendon to the graft table. Penis longus tendon, usually you will get a length is quite good, about 22 to 29 centimeter. And after double folding or triple folding, you will get diameter from 8 millimeter to 9.5 and 10 millimeter. So regarding length and graft, it is diameter is quite good option for ACLR. Here the graft both end was wedge stitched, then folded, double folded, and an endo button was inserted. Rest of the things are quite similar to other option. And after this is the graft, and then take the measure about the diameter, and after that the rest of the things are similar to other ACLR technique. Here you can see the tendon passes through the tibial and femoral tunnel. It's quite good thick graft. So regarding graft harvesting, to avoid potential injury to the sural nerve, you have to go through the skin and subcutaneous tissue. Then after cutting the skin and subcutaneous tissue, you have to go bluntly up to the superficial peroneal retinaculum to avoid injury to the sural nerve, because sometimes you will get, if you injure the, somebody will get the paresthesia, hypostasia along the lateral border of the sole or lower leg. And another important thing, it's also in the very good article. Here you can see the end of the stripper, and this is the common peroneal nerve, and how close it is. If you push in the upper part of the leg, then you can injure the common peroneal nerve. So it's better to mark a horizontal line just 5 centimeters below the fibular head. And regarding superficial planar, it lies deep to the deep plane. So if you go, if you push your stripper or parallel to the muscle plane, so you are not injured the superficial planar nerve. Now, what are the concerns regarding perineus longus tendon harvesting? Possible complication arising from the loss of the perineus longus tendon include ankle's instability, decreased flexion strength in the first ray and ankle eversion, hypostasia, paresthesia on the lateral border of the foot and sole, and transient weakness in the eversion. So let's see what literature says. Donor side model, regarding donor side model, there are four or five studies, and all shows that ankle eversion, first ray plantar flexion strength were measured using the dynamometer 6 months after surgery, and using the foot ankle disability index or AOFAS scoring system. This shows there is no donor side morbidity regarding eversion and first ray plantar flexion strength. This is another study which shows that flexion and eversion also, there is no compromising or compromise of the flexion and eversion of the ankle. This is an interesting study which shows that perineus brevis is more effective inverted than perineus longus. So if you take the perineus longus, so there will be no hamper of the eversion in ankle. Regarding functional outcome, this is a meta-analysis which shows that perineus longus autograft significantly better Leishman and IKTC subjective scores than the HT autograft. Given these findings, they conclude that PLT autograft is suitable alternative graft choice for knee patients in case of ACL reconstructions. Mainly studies are from Indonesian group and the Chinese group, and there are some studies from Indian also. They show that functional outcome is quite good. It's comparable to other grafts. But the one thing is that the studies are, the follow-ups are quite short. That is 6 to 2 years, and a number of patients is also less. So these are the other studies. All studies shows the better outcome, functional outcome using perineus longus tendon. So to conclude, PLT has excellent biomechanical properties, and it can be harvested easily and safely due to its superficial location. Full thickness PLT autograft can easily provide adequate strength, most clinical scenario, especially for ACLR. No significant donor side morbidity has been reported after harvesting. Routine use of PLT as primary source of graft needs further for long-term evaluation of a large number of patients. Thank you very much for patience hearing.
Thank you, Dr. Chaudhary. And I think now I will share my screen. It's a video presentation of ACL reconstruction, and we will have a question at the end of the session. So arthroscopic ACL reconstruction, as you know, it's one of the commonest ligament to be reconstructed, and it's a small video presentation of ACL reconstruction with semi-T graft. And the first and most important part is you should assess the instability on the anesthesia. Just most of the time you can see it's a demonstrable pivot, and once you put your scope inside, you can see if it's an old injury, it's an empty fossa sign. Sometime you get a ACL which is attached with the PCL, or sometime you get such remnant of ACL only. So try to remove remnant and try to palpate the whole of the medial surface of the lateral femoral condyle from posterior to anterior spread, and you can see whole of the ACL footprint. And the most important part is your anatomical femoral tunnel should be encroaching the whole of the femoral footprint. And this is the technique. Either you can use your jig, or you can use your 4 millimeter cannulated guide wire as a guide. Here you can see I am using a 4 millimeter cannulated drill bit, and I'm putting it over the center of the ACL footprint. And that is the best way. You can just put it in anatomical position. This is one of the way where you can avoid using this offset also. So over that, once you pass your B-twin, you have to drill your 4 millimeter drill bit through the lateral femoral cortex. And be careful here, you can palpate it, and sometimes it's very easy if in expert hand to see, palpate the lateral wall, and that will be your femoral tunnel length. You can see I am 35, I'm going inside, and once you have just over the lateral wall, you can see you will get a giving weight sensation. So it's always better. And now if you want, when you are put, when you are making your femoral tunnel, always try to protect your PCL, because there's every chance by this flower rimmer that it will damage the PCL. With your probe, try to retract your PCL and while rimming, and that will help in preventing injury to the PCL, the fibers of the PCL. So now suppose you want your 20 graft or 25 graft inside, so you should rim it with your flower rimmer, the desired which is the desired equal to your graft diameter. So 20, 25 or 30 millimeter, whatever graft you want is inside the femoral tunnel. It's advisable that minimum 15 to 20 millimeter of graft should be inside the femoral tunnel, not less than that, not less than that. So once you have make your femoral tunnel, always assure that there's a 10 millimeter of lateral cortex there. And this is very important step. So visualization of the femoral tunnel through the accessory medial portal or the anteromedial portal. And you should see whole of the 360 degree visualization of this is very important, because sometimes you may have a posterior wall blowout, or you may have an inferior wall blowout, or you may have a posterior superior wall blowout. So visualize the tunnel, because once you have a wall blowout, you don't have any option. Always use a suspensory fixation only. Never use the aperture fixation whenever you have a femoral posterior femoral wall blowout. So once you have inspected your tunnel, say it's okay. Now you can measure it also. You can see your tunnel length is 45. So your tunnel length is 45. So if I want to put 25 millimeter graft inside, I will put my 20 millimeter, take a 20 millimeter loop. This is the second most important step of the tibial footprint. And there are three anatomical landmarks. First thing is you can see your medial tibial spiral top point, just anterior to the anterior horn of the lateral meniscus, on 6 to 7 millimeter anterior to the PCL. So these are three landmarks. Of these three, the most important landmark, the fixed landmark, is your medial tibial spine. So I use this landmark, the drop point of the medial tibial spine, which is very important landmark. And it's a fixed bony landmark, which is there in every injured ACL injury patient. You can see the other landmark is anterior to the anterior of the lateral meniscus, or 6 to 7 millimeter anterior to the PCL. But believe me, medial tibial spine drop point is the best landmark for your tibial footprint. So put your tibial jig, now fire your bit pin, drill the tibial tunnel over the bit pin. You can see here, and sometimes it's better to remove the soft tissue from the tibial tunnel to have a smooth passage of the graft. You can see here, and now visualize your tibial tunnel. Now pass your wire from the femoral tunnel to the tibial tunnel. Over that, just railroad your graft, and you can see here, the marking is there. So one vicryl mark is there over 25. So once my 25 mark is there over the medial border of the lateral femoral condyle, I can flip my endo pattern. And this is the classical flipping feeling which you will feel over the lateral femoral cortex. So once your button has been flipped, it's time for cyclic loading, because that will, if there is any amount of giving way or laxity inside the graft, you can just cover that. Now you should fix your tibial tunnel with an, here I am fixing it with an aperture fixation. I can see the tension in the graft with adequate tension is there. Three things is important while you are doing this ACL reconstruction. You should not have any impingement of the graft with the medial femoral, with the lateral femoral condyle. You should not have any impingement of the graft with your PCL, and you should not have any impingement of the graft with the roof. So if you say what is the ideal ACL graft, so it should not have three impingement. First thing, wall impingement, there should be no roof impingement, there should not be any PCL impingement. Here you can see after tensioning of the graft, check for the three impingement. The first thing is the roof impingement. In full extension, see the anterior border of the graft is not touching the roof, so there is no roof impingement. And most of this anatomical ACL reconstruction should not have any roof impingement, because we are putting an oblique graft. Then you can see there is no second thing is put your probe in between the lateral femoral condyle and graft, and see at least 2 to 3 millimeter gap is there. So there should not be any wall impingement. And you, if you probe is sliding gently over the PCL, in between PCL and ACL, there is no PCL impingement. And these are the three important tips by which you can prevent impingement of the ACL grout with any of these three anatomical structures. Thank you. I think now we will have talk by Dr. Clement Joseph, sir. So, sir, we will give an overview, and I think Yugal will give a video demonstration. Sir, that is the plan. Sir, you please unmute yourself, sir.
Yes, Rajiv, that's a plan. I'll also show a small video clip.
All right, sir.
Yes. Technique. I'll are you going to have some questions about ACL because we are going to the next territory?
Yeah.
Or should I share the screen?
Yes, if you share the screen, we will have question at the end of the session.
Right. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Good evening, everyone, and thanks to Biotech for organizing this wonderful seminar. And I'm so honored, and it's very glad to be part of this meeting along with our friends from Bangladesh. It's a new interaction with them. Thank you once again. I'm going to talk on the anterolateral reconstruction, which is gaining much more popularity now. Because as we are critically analyzing our ACLs, we can see that many of them, or at least few of them, are not up to the mark. Research from this Moon cohort study has shown that 30% of our ACL reconstructed patients do not return to sports. Of those who go back to sports, only 43% can play at the same level. So this is of concern to us. And coming to the re-injury, especially if the patient is of young age, less than 18 years, the re-tear rate is nearly 23%. And the risk of re-injury becomes much more if they return to a high level of sports. The re-injury and re-rate in an operated knee is 30 to 40 times more than the contralateral re. And also, if you do an extensive medial meniscectomy, it can lead to clinical failures. And also, after your ACL reconstruction, if the knee still has a persistent residual rotational laxity, it can lead to long-term effects like meniscal or condolesions, which eventually can lead to degenerative joint disease. So are we assessing the residual rotational laxity after doing your ACL reconstruction? Do we need to have a different plan for patients with high-grade pivot shift? Does medial meniscectomy influence the outcomes of our surgery? And what is the role of lateral meniscectomy? It has been shown to be an important internal rotation restraint by Get Good at All. So all these questions need to be answered before you plan for ACL reconstruction in patients, especially in the 21st century. First, let's see the pivot shift mechanism. So this is a pictorial representation. You can see the ACL in the center and the anterolateral structures or anterolateral ligament here on the outside. You can see the internal rotation depicted here. For this internal rotation is a pivot shift. The internal tibial rotation arc is happening on the periphery of the tibia, whereas ACL is the center point of the pivoting. In patients who have an isolated ACL tear without any injury to the anterolateral structures, as you can see in this picture, the central pivoting point now moves to the medial collateral ligament. So there could be a slight, but it won't be a marked high-grade shift. This has been shown in laboratory studies by Ames et al., in which when they sectioned the ACL, they were not able to get a pivot shift test unless the anterolateral structures have also been torn. And look at the third picture, for example, where the ACL as well as the ALL is torn. You can see not only the center point of pivot moves to the MCL, there is also no restraint on the periphery of the lateral tibial condyle, which allows a greater internal rotation. So this is what happens in high grade PVOship, there could be an injury of ACL as well as anterolateral ligament reconstruction. In this case of this combined high grade injuries, if you do only ACL reconstruction, you may be shifting the center point of pivot to the center, but you may not have any control over the arc of rotation which happens on the periphery. To understand, one should think of pivot shift as a complex movement which happens not only anteroposterior but also along a helical axis. And one should be very careful when you observe a high grade pivot shift like this. So if you are doing ACL reconstruction alone for this complex problem, you may be offering a two-dimensional solution for a three-dimensional problem. So we will never fully understand the rotatory instability if you look only at the ACL. So this is a conclusion by Monaco and Ferretti, who have done a lot of studies on anterolateral reconstructions. And many times the solution is to think outside the box. As an arthroscopic surgeon, we've been focusing inside the joint for so much. We've been trying different graft types. We have been doing different graft positions like over the top and anatomical bundle reconstructions and a double bundle reconstruction. But it's time for us to go outside the joint and think outside the box. And in this scenario, one has to understand the anterolateral complex, the structures which are on the lateral side and the anterior aspect of the knee, which provide anterolateral rotatory stability. The first and foremost would be the IT band with its deep capsular extensions called Kaplan fibers. They are considered to be very important in providing stability. And a lot of studies have identified this anterolateral ligament, which is a condensation which is found in the lateral capsule. And people disagree whether it is a true ligament or not, depending on which side you come from. But definitely, these structures play a role in controlling the rotatory instability. For a significant pivot shift to happen, not only the ACL, but the ALL and also part of the IT band fibers should be injured. MRI evaluation of this high-grade pivot shift injuries showed nearly 50% incidence of anterolateral complex injuries. And Ferretti and et al., who have done surgical exploration in all their cases of ACL reconstruction, found at least some injury to the anterolateral structures in at least 90% of ACL tears. So this is something which you should concern us, and many of our ACL reconstructions may need an anterolateral procedure as well. And looking historically, before the advent of arthroscopy, we have been treating ACL tears with extra-articular procedures, as you can see on the left side, which even my mentor, Dr. David Rajan, used to do before he started doing all arthroscopic ACL reconstruction. They've been taking strips of IT band and weaving around the posterolateral area and pulling it back to the tibia and attaching, the typical Marshall McIntosh procedure. But then we left the anterolateral side and went inside the joint. We were doing single bundle, double bundle and everything, but still we are not having the desired results. And now we have come to realize that at least some ACL reconstructions, which are high-grade injuries, do require not only ACL reconstruction inside the joint, but they also need a lateral extra-articular procedure. And it is a clinical decision because MRI may not pick up an anterolateral injury in many cases, and the Sigon fracture, which is also an osseous avulsion of the anterolateral ligament, may not be seen in many patients. And many studies have shown the superiority of a single bundle ACL reconstruction done along with the lateral procedure when compared to single bundle ACL as well as double bundle ACL. And especially when added to hamstrings, it achieves better control of anterolateral rotations, according to Zaffanini et al. And coming to the lateral extra-articular procedures, there are two types we can do. You can use a gracilis as a free graft. And one can also use the locally available iliotibial band strip to do the anterolateral reconstruction. In our practice, the indications for doing lateral extra-articular procedure would be a grade 3 pivot, joint laxity, especially women who have loose joints, very young patients who are into contact sports, and almost all cases of revision ACL surgeries, I add a lateral extra-articular procedure. And the technique which I'll be showing is how to use gracilis tendon with very minimal approach incisions. It's almost, you can call it as a percutaneous technique. It requires no implants in the tibia, and one can have a lateral row anchors which we use for your shoulder rotator cuff repairs in this procedure. So this is the schema of the surgical procedure. You can see the ACL is attached here. One should avoid the ACL, go proximal to the lateral epicondyle and slightly posterior. This is a posterior proximal position which is advocated. From here, the graft is loaded into the suture anchor and fixed in the position of ALL. From there, it goes into a tunnel, a small unicortical tunnel, which is 10 to 12 millimeter from the joint line, and which is situated somewhere between the fibula head and the Gerdes tubercle. And you also make another small tunnel, a centimeter from the first tunnel, and in a slightly converging manner. These two tunnels can be connected with the help of a curved artery forceps or a 90-degree artery forceps. The graft is passed from the suture anchor and brought out through the tunnel back here. And then the anchors which we use will also have two holding sutures. The graft is taken over there. The holding sutures are tied over the graft. The graft is folded back. Once again, the sutures are tied over. So this is a video which you can appreciate here. You can see the joint line is being marked. The fibular head is marked. A centimeter from the fibular head, the first tunnel marking is done. The Gerdes tubercle is marked. And the second marking for the second tunnel is done. A centimeter incision is made in these two marked locations, 12 millimeter below the joint line. The soft tissues are spread. And a guide pin is inserted. Over it, we are using a 4.5 cannulated reamer to make a tunnel of around a centimeter or two. The second tunnel, 4.5 reamer over the guide wire. The 90-degree right-angled artery forceps is used to connect both these tunnels. Then an Etibon suture is passed from this bony opening from one tunnel to the next tunnel. And it is pulled to check that it is in fact inside the bone. Then one has to palpate the lateral epicondyle here. And a centimeter, 2 centimeter incision is made. The soft tissues are spread to expose the IT band. The IT band is split over the lateral epicondyle along the line of its fibers. As you can see, the IT band is split here. And this is an awl which can be used for the suture anchor introduction. You can see the ACL reconstruction has already been done, and our entry avoids the ACL implant. Under the IT band, Etibon suture loop is passed. The graft is loaded onto the suture anchor and inserted into the socket. And then the suture anchor is inserted to produce an interference fit for the graft. Now the holding sutures are removed and the anchor handle is removed. Now the graft is shuttled under the IT band through the first opening. And then from the first opening through the tunnel, the graft is shuttled into the second opening here. So now the graft is going through the tibial, interconnected tibial tunnels. And now once again, it is taken back under the IT band back to the epicondylar region. Now the holding sutures from the suture anchor are tied over the graft. 3 to 4 knots are made. The graft is folded. Then further knots are made. The advantage of this procedure is you're not drilling the femoral epicondyle. So virtually there is no risk of damaging your ACL grafts after you've done ACL reconstruction. And you can see there is a good control of rotational stability even before you fix the tibial side of the ACL. So a lot of studies have shown that adding an extra articular lateral procedure reduces your graft re-rupture rates. It can also bring down the rates of clinical failures following ACL reconstruction. To conclude, residual or persistent rotatory laxity is a problem following ACL reconstruction. It's very important to address this issue by identifying high-grade ACL injuries. And even after you perform a proper ACL reconstruction, it is very important to examine for residual rotatory laxity. If you find residual rotatory laxity even after an ACL reconstruction, you can add a lateral extra-articular procedure when needed. And in our hands, this percutaneous technique of using Gracilis graft for doing extra-articular procedure has been very helpful and non-invasive, and our results have been very encouraging. Thanks for your attention. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for a wonderful video demonstration. It's a new technique, learned a lot. Sir, please stop sharing your screen. Now I'd like to invite Dr. Yugal to share his presentation.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you, the Biotech, Dr. Clement sir, and other senior faculties to give me the opportunity to present my presentation here. So after a detailed talk of Dr. Clement sir, we can understand the importance of the anterolateral ligament reconstruction in the patients with ACL injury. So this is a case of revision ACL in which we have done the BPTV graft we have used. We can see even after ACL reconstruction, there is a residual vert shift, which is positive. So that means in spite of ACL reconstruction, there are certain extra structures on the lateral aspect of the knee which are responsible for this pivot. So the structure which is mainly responsible for the rotational instability is anterolateral ligament. There are a lot of studies done regarding the origin, but most of the studies, they postulated that anterolateral ligament is basically a part of anterolateral capsule, and it is difficult to identify it separately. Coming to the origin and insertion of the anterolateral ligament, there are a lot of theories proposed, but the most commonly accepted theory was by Kennedy and its group, who says that we should draw a line which is parallel to the posterior femoral cortex and another line which is perpendicular to this line, and it should bisect at the Blumen sites line posterior most point, and the femoral tunnel ALL insertion point, it is in the posteroinferior quadrant, 4 millimeter posterior and proximal to the lateral epicondyle. The tibial insertion site, it is at the midpoint from the lateral tibial plateau and 1 centimeter below the joint line. So here, I think my arrow is visible. So this black point in the femoral side and the tibial side, it indicates the insertion sites. Now it is very important that during ALL reconstruction, whether to decide it preoperatively or intraoperatively. Pre-op decision for ALL reconstruction, it is generally made for the patients of ACL injury with generalized laxity, or if they have grade 3 or grade 4 pivot shift, in cases of revision ACL injuries, or in sports person who play contact sports. Sometimes, apart from these patients, we get simple ACL reconstructions, but if the residual pivot is positive, even after ACL reconstruction intraoperatively, we should do the ALL reconstruction. The grafts which we use for ALL reconstruction, it could be Gracilis or the IT band strip. Gracilis is used if the ACL is reconstructed with quadruple samety. If both the hamstrings are used for the ACL reconstruction, then we can go with the IT band strip reconstruction. So there are certain technical difficulties which we find in ALL reconstruction. First of all, if the decision of ALL reconstruction is intraop, it becomes technically difficult sometimes. And the problem of tunnel convergence in cases of combined ACL and ALL reconstruction, because the position of ALL and ACL tunnels on the femoral side, it is very close. So sometimes it may lead to the damage to the reconstructed ACL graft. So if it's a pre-op decision of ALL reconstruction, the femoral tunnels, they can be modified a little, like if we can plan the little distal and posterior as compared to the normal tunnels, or if we go for the outside in technique of the femoral tunneling for the ACL reconstruction, it should be helpful. Coming to the tunnel cover convergence of the combined tunnels. So here is a study done by Smeeds and group, which they published in 2018. This was a study done on 30 cadaveric knees in which they drilled the ALL femur tunnel in two ways. Here, if you can see the A, tunnel A in both the pictures, it is made at 0 degree coronal angulation and 20 degree axial angulation. And the tunnel B, they have made it with 30 degree coronal and 30 degree axial angulation. They have done the CT evaluation of tunnels in all the 30 cadaveric knees, and they found that out of 30 cadaveric knees, 20 in 20 knees, there was a tunnel convergence. But the tunnel convergence risk is less if ALL tunnel is made with 30 degree axial and coronal angulation. So this thing we should keep in mind when we are doing the ALL reconstruction. Again, when we drill the femoral tunnel with the help of remus, sometimes it is uncontrolled or the torque of the remus, it is too high. We can damage the ACL graft easily. So we have modified the ALL fixation technique on the femoral tunnel side. Normally we use the knotless anchors. The diameter of the punch which is used for the knotless anchor socket formation, it is 4.75 mm. And since we are not reaming the tunnel, so it is a controlled formation which reduces the femoral tunnel destruction. And as well as it reduces the risk of damage to ACL graft or the suspensory threads of the adjustable loop system used for ACL reconstruction. So here are pictorial pictures for the lateral extraarticular tenodesis. So we should identify the three structures, Gerdy's tubercle, fibular head, and the lateral epicondyle. Make an incision from Gerdy's tubercle to 4 to 5 centimeter proximal. Take a strip of IT band with a 1 centimeter width, and approximately the length should be 8 to 8.5 centimeter, because normally the studies show the approximate length of ALL in normal individuals, it is 6 centimeter. And we should take extra 2 to 2.5 centimeter beyond this to insert it into the femoral socket. After taking the graft, whip stitches are taken with the help of 2 ethibond sutures or the fiber wires. Identify the LCL, pass the graft under the lateral collateral ligament, and then fix it in the femoral tunnel and close the IT band with the final closure. So here's the video demonstration of that. So here we can see there is a grade 3 pivot. So we planned for the ACL reconstruction along with the ALL. Here the IT band strip is dissected. IT bond suture is passed. The dissection was done distally till Gerdy's tubercle. Now here we measure the from the Gerdy's tubercle a distance of 8 centimeter proximally, and we just mark on the skin so that our we have an idea to take a graft till that skin mark. But intraoperatively, while dissecting proximally, we again we will check it the length of the ALL, depending on the location of the lateral epicondyle. So here the mark is made, and the lateral epicondyle is felt. Here we should remember one thing, the point of femoral insertion site. So we should take 2 centimeter more from that insertion site on the IT band strip. So the proximal dissection has been done. Whip stitches are taken through the edge of the IT band strip with the help of 2 ethibond. Now the dissection is done to identify the lateral collateral ligament. After identifying the lateral collateral ligament, a relay ethibond suture is passed under it. Now we are marking the lateral epicondyle, and we do the deep dissection to identify the lateral epicondyle. Till this stage, the ACL has not been fixed in the tibial fixation site, tibial tunnel site. So here we can identify, after dissection, we can see there is a endo button of the adjustable loop system, which is visible. And visualizing it, we can make the femoral socket very easily. So here we are using the punch for the lateral row anchor, and it is a controlled formation. Now the sutures are passed, and through the relay sutures, the graft is taken under the LCL. These sutures are passed through the lateral row anchor. And here we are fixing the graft. We are inserting it into the femoral socket with the help of Biotech lateral row anchor. So after tightening the screws, we can see the ethibond sutures have become loose. It means the all the 2 centimeters inside, and the anchor all is withdrawn. Now that this pivot is negative, in spite of fixing the ACL graft in the tibial tunnel site. So it means the rotational instability, it is mainly due to the injury to the anterolateral ligament or the lateral complex as compared to the ACL. So we should always examine the knee laxity after the ACL graft fixation, and ALL reconstruction should be used as a la carte approach. And if it's necessary, whether you decide preoperatively or intraoperatively, it is must to do it to avoid the ACL failure rates. And ALL reconstruction using the knotless anchor, it reduces the risk of the ACL graft damage. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Yugal. Excellent video demonstration of extra-articular tenderness. Now, Professor Dr. Hassan Masood, he will be sharing his experience on ACL avulsion fixation. Dr. Hassan Masood, please share your screen.
Yes. Thank you, Dr. Rajib Raman. Am I audible?
Yeah.
And the screen is visible also, no?
Yeah, make it in PowerPoint mode.
Okay.
Fantastic. Yes, we can see now.
So good evening, panel of experts and the learned audience. And thanks, Biotech, for making me a part of this August academic gathering. So I will be talking on ACL avulsion, and I will show the real life video. So the anterior cruciate ligament injuries with bony avulsion most commonly involve tibial attachment of the ACL, resulting in what is termed a tibial eminence or tibial spine avulsion fracture. There are 2 different types of spine fractures, the spine fracture in the adolescent and in the adult. The adolescent spine fracture is an avulsion fracture with the original force taking place through the ACL. The adult fracture is a direct contusion of a condyle of the femur against the spine of the tibia. The spine fracture in adolescent is almost combined with weakening of the ACL. And this ACL avulsion fracture vary considerably in fragment size, displacement, and comminution. The most commonly used classification system categorizes 4 fracture patterns, which are based on the degree of displacement of the tibial attachment of the ACL. Meyers and McKeever first described the classification scheme for tibial eminence fracture in 1959, but later it was modified. So the classification system, type 1, non-displaced or minimally displaced anterior margin. Type 2, the anterior 1/3 to 1/2 of the fragment is displaced. Type 3A, complete displacement of the fragment. Type 3B, complete displacement and cephalad rotation of the fragment. And type 4, the comminution of the fragment. So the clinical presentation, mostly it is a pediatric injury. In adolescent, the origin of the trauma is mostly a sports accident, and rarely it is seen in adults. In adult, mostly motor vehicle accident is the cause. The patient typically presents with an acutely swollen, painful knee with severely restricted motion. And patient says that it is difficult for walking. Excuse me. The patient may present acutely, or also there is late presentation. And historically, ACL avulsion fracture were thought to occur almost exclusively in the pediatric population because of the relative weakness of the incompletely ossified tibial plateau. A review of current literature, however, revealed that 45% of the reported ACL avulsion fractures occurred in the adult. So the treatment plan, the goal for management of the tibial eminence fractures should be no different than for any other intra-articular fracture. Anatomic reduction and rigid fixation that allows for early range of motion should be the treatment for these fractures. Excuse me. Management has been based on the Myers and McIver classification with recommendations for immobilization in extension for the type 1 fracture. Some controversy exists as to what degree the knee is to be extended for non-operative management. Myers and McIver recommend immobilization in 20 degrees of flexion. Similarly, BT and Kumar recommend immobilization in 10 to 15 degrees of flexion. But Jackson et al. Based their recommendations of flexing the knee to 30 to 40 degrees because the ACL is taut in extension, and with some flexion, the tension on the avulsion fragment would be less. But most of the authors favor immobilization in full extension to avoid a flexion contracture, which can occur if the knee is kept in flexed position. So treatment of type 2 fracture. Treatment of type 2 fractures is more variable. They can be treated with closed reduction in extension and cast immobilization, or with arthroscopic reduction and internal fixation. Arthroscopic reduction and internal fixation is indicated if a type 2 fracture cannot be reduced in extension, or if it converts to a type 3 in extension. Approximately half of type 2 fractures are irreducible. Of these, 26% have entrapment of soft tissue within the fracture. Arthroscopic reduction and internal fixation also is advocated for all type 2 fractures in knees that have concurrent meniscal tears. And now come to type 3 and type 4 fractures. Arthroscopic reduction and internal fixation is recommended for all type 3 and type 4 fractures. 65% of the type 3 fractures contain entrapped soft tissue that must be retracted before fracture reduction. Arthroscopy examination is the best way to determine whether concomitant meniscal or chondral injuries are present and whether the tibial spine fracture is comminuted. Fractures that appear to be type 3 on radiographs can be discovered to be type 4 when examined arthroscopically. And there are various modes of fixation, like screw with and without a washer, 4 millimeter cannulated cancellous screw, fully threaded, then a stainless steel or titanium wire, fiber wire and suture post or suture disc, threaded Krishna wire, suture anchors, and recently also the staples. So there are controversies. Previously, open reduction was done, but now arthroscopic reduction is the choice for less morbidity, faster rehabilitation, and decreased pain. And there is controversy about screw versus suture fixation. So in case of screw fixation, higher risk of fragment comminution, arthrogenic ligament injury, posterior neurovascular injury are common. So there are also potential need for hardware removal. So that an accurate assessment of the fracture size and degree of fragment comminution is important because the integrity of the fragment determines the type of internal fixation required. Cannulated screw fixation is more rigid than suture fixation, but it should be used only in non-comminuted fragments that are at least 3 times the width of the screw. Suture fixation is recommended if the tibial spine fragment is smaller than 1 centimeter diameter or is comminuted. And now about my video. AR is a 25-year-old university student who presents to clinic with a painful left knee. He reports that a motorcycle fell down on his leg and he sustained trauma to his left knee and his knee became swollen at the time. He was initially seen at a local emergency department and was discharged with a knee immobilizer and sent to an orthopedic surgeon for follow-up. On presentation to the clinic, he was 2 weeks from the initial injury, was non-weight bearing, and was wearing the knee immobilizer. And this is the X-ray. Plain radiographs revealed a displaced tibial eminence fracture. This is the displaced tibial eminence fracture, consistent with the type 3 avulsion fracture. There are no other significant plain film findings. And these are the MRI findings. MRI also performed, which revealed a complete avulsion of the tibial eminence with no other significant pathology present. Suture fixation should be used when the fracture is small, comminuted, or in the presence of open growth plates. Some have advocated using the suture methods for all cases as less risk, neurovascular bundle, and less secondary procedures. Hardware removal are seen. And I am also in favor of this suture fixation. And now the surgical technique. General anesthesia or epidural anesthesia may be given. And a tourniquet is placed around the thigh, but it is not routinely used. Standard knee positioning and portals can be used to evaluate the fracture. And this is the Ewers fragment. A fluid pump is used to promote hemostasis and adequate visualization. And you see, the hemostasis is evacuated in recent cases and the fracture fragment with ACL insertion is lifted, allowing the removal of clots and interposed soft tissue. Shevar is used to further debride the region and to remove any debris from the fracture bed. And once the fracture site has been debrided, the fragment should be reduced. Interposition of the intermeniscal ligament or the menisci requires use of the probe to hold the soft tissue structures out of the way while attempting to reduce the fragment with an ACL guide or probe. In cases in which the intermeniscal ligament prevents reduction and also cannot be mobilized, resection is performed. After the fracture is reduced and held in position with the Steinman pin, the ACL tibial tunnel guide is used to pass a guide wire through the anteromedial tibial metaphysis and through the medial side of the fragment. See here, after introducing a guide wire, a cannulated 4.5 millimeter drill is passed over the guide wire and the tunnel is drilled through. It is one tunnel and we have to do another tunnel also. And a second wire is passed starting 1 to 2 centimeters lateral to the first hole on the tibial cortex, entering the knee at the lateral side of the fragment. Then cannulated 4.5 millimeter drill is passed over the guide wire and the tunnel is drilled through. The wire is removed and immediately after removal, a suture passer is passed up the hole and a number 5 Ethibond suture are delivered through the loop in the knee joint with the help of a grasper. See, this is retrieved through the help of a grasper from the guide a suture passer. And now the second wire is taken out and the suture retriever is immediately placed into the joint through the second tunnel. And the loop of the number 5 Ethibond are caught by the suture retriever and pulled out of the tibia. And now, after pulling out of the tibia in the subcutaneous tissue, a crochet hook or a bland probe is passed into the subcutaneous tissue through one of the suture holes, hooking the opposite sutures and pulling them out the same hole. A knot is tied and passed through the skin puncture hole and subcutaneous tissue is secured tightly to the tibial cortex. Each suture is tied and secured individually. You see, this is the suture retriever in the second tunnel. Here, the Ethibond is retrieved. Through the suture retriever. Yes. And it is passed out through the tunnel. And then the both it are given a knot. So this is the post-op X-ray. So there are also some complications during these procedures. These are the common complications seen, like arthrofibrosis is a potential complication, but it is rare if the patient undergoes arthroscopic reduction with the fixation, because the goal of the operation is to promote early range of motion. Loss of full extension can be avoided by immobilization in full extension and attention to quadriceps and hamstring strengthening. Painful or symptomatic hardware is common with the use of cannulated screws. Loss of full knee extension can occur secondary to scar tissue or a prominent screw in the intercondylar notch. Now, this patient represents an example of a non-traditional injury to the ACL. Tibial eminence fractures often are misunderstood to be only childhood injuries, when in fact they also occur in the adult population. And treating this injury pattern with arthroscopic reduction and internal fixation allows for anatomic reduction and early range of motion. The advantage of bony healing provides a rapid healing rate and good clinical outcomes. The patient did well postoperatively and represents the success that it was possible with treating tibial eminence fractures with this method. Thank you.
Thank you, Asanda, for a wonderful presentation. I think now we have our last talk by Dr. Mohammad Abdulhai from Chittagong, a very active arthroscopy surgeon in that part of country from Bangladesh. So he will be talking about overlooked aspect of knee injury, the collateral ligaments. Abdullah.
Am I audible?
Yeah, you are audible and your screen is also visible. Yes.
Good evening. Welcome you all to this discussion. I am Dr. Abdulhai from Chittagong, part of the Bangladesh. Today I am talking about the overlooked aspects of the knee injuries, that's collateral ligaments, It's a short discussion. Though we think the multiple ligament injuries are rare, but potentially disabling, and when it's a neglected traumatic events. There are important things are medial collateral ligament, lateral collateral ligaments. Though now these all are recognizing in past several years, but lack of consensus among the experts regarding the how to treat the multiple ligament injuries. Though in today's discussion, nicely discussion was done about the anterolateral ligaments. Now I am talking a little about the medial collateral ligaments. Medial knee stabilizer, there are static and dynamic. Static stabilizers are superficial MCL, deep MCL, and posterior oblique ligament. Dynamic stabilizers are medial head of the gastrocnemius, basencephalus, semimembranosus, and vastus medialis muscles. MCL anatomies, there is medial collateral ligament. There is two layers, superficial and deep. Functionally, superficial MCL is the main valgus stabilizer of the knee in all flexion angles. And deep MCL is a secondary valgus stabilizer. It has only minor role in preventing the anterior tibial translation. Posterior oblique ligament also acts as a stabilizer of the valgus and internal rotation stabilizer. And a little about the anatomies, the superficial MCL and deep MCL, all are known to us. In deep MCL, there is divided into two part, meniscofemoral and meniscotibial portion. And posterior oblique ligaments anatomies are originated at the medial femur, distal to the adductor tubercle and posterior to the superficial MCL origin, and insertion in the posterior medial corner of the tibia. And MCL anatomy, the medial side of the knee joints, they are divided in three layers. In layer one, outermost, that are the sartorius and the crural fascia that covers the both head of the gastro and neurovascular strata structures and blend with the layer two anteriorly. In between layer one and two, there are semitendinous and gracilis. In layer two, there is superficial MCL and posterior oblique ligaments are situated in layer two. In layer three, these are the deep structures, that is capsule, deep MCL, and coronary ligaments. MCLs are anterior portion of the MCL are taut in the flexion, and posterior portion of the MCL is taut in extension. There is 1 to 2 centimeter excursion during the flexion normally, and tight in the external rotation. MCL injury mechanism, this is typically a force to the lateral aspects of the leg or lower thigh, that is clipping injuries in football or basketball or like sports. Most commonly the rupture that typically occurs at the femoral insertion site. Tibial site avulsion are rare. Physical examination, the valgus stress test, this is done at 0 degree and at 30 degree of flexion. 30 degree flexion, valgus stress test is more important. The MCL injury severity grades in 1, 2, and 3. Physiologically, there is 2 millimeter of excursion, but in grade 1 injury, there is 1 to 5 millimeter of opening up of the joint line. In grade 2, there is 5 to 9 millimeter. In grade 3, plus 10. And degree is there is tenderness, but no instability in grade 1. In grade 2, there is valgus laxity with soft or firm endpoint. In grade 3, there is no endpoint. There is imaging, the routine x-ray. In routine x-ray, we found the steady lesion in the chronic injuries. MCL injuries, imaging most common and most important thing is the MRI. In MRI determines the details of the MCL injuries in T2 weight images. In grade 1 injuries, there's intact ligament, but intact ligament signals, but edema around the ligaments. In grade 2, partial rupture or intrasubstance. In grade 2, partial rupture, abnormal signals within the ligament itself, or fluid surrounding the ligament. In grade C, complete rupture. Yes, we have non-operative treatment in MCL injuries. Isolated injury to the MCL results in a robust healing process because of there is rich in blood supply and a relatively wide surface area of attachment and associated with other secondary stabilizers, their non-operative treatment works well. And 80% return to the sports within the 9 weeks. Indication of operative treatments are specific when there is open injury, when MCL entrapment causing the incongruent reduction of the tibia femoral joint and fracture avulsion of the MCL origin, distal MCL avulsion which entrapped in the patient's serenus, multi-ligament injuries, other injuries requiring the surgeries, and chronic instability after non-operative management, then we have to do the operative treatments. There's different techniques. I'm showing the only pictorial presentation. This anatomic double bundle MCL reconstruction. It is single bundle and non-anatomic double bundle MCL reconstruction. Another one is the modified Bosworth non-anatomic double bundle transfer of the CMT. There is a role of internal bracing also when there is grade 1 or grade 2 injuries. Rehabilitation is the important aspects of the MCL injuries, that is protected weight bearing in hinged knee brace after the MCL reconstruction, and 0 to 90 degree of range of motion should be permitted up to 2 weeks. Then gradual flexion is allowed up to 6 weeks. Discontinuation of the brace after 6 to 8 weeks. Avoid pivoting for 16 weeks. Jogging after 16 to 20 weeks. Return to play after 9 months. Another injuries are the lateral collateral ligaments injuries. Incidence of lateral collateral ligament injury or PLC injuries is not accurately known, often undetected to the young surgeons. Isolated injuries to the PLC are rare. Lateral collateral ligament is the primary stabilizer to the varus stress of the knee joint. Here the different portion, fibular collateral ligament, and this is the popliteal fibular ligament. This is popliteus tendon. These are the lateral stabilizers of the knee joint. All the details anatomies are well known to us, so I'm not discussing this. And lateral collateral ligament that is tight in extension and lax in flexion, and greater external rotation resistance in full extension. PCL resists posterior translation of the tibia, and isolated sectioning had no effect on external rotation in case of PCL. Yes, three most important structures to control the varus and external rotation is the lateral collateral ligament, popliteus tendon, and the popliteo fibular ligament. Lateral collateral ligament injuries are commonly done by blow to the intermedial tibia, hyperextension injuries, and direct varus blow to the flexed knee, combined with the ACL or PCL injuries. It's adduction abduction stress test we found in case of lateral collateral ligament injuries. The dial test is the most important test for the injuries. Truly at 30 degree of knee flexion, we found the dial test 10 degree difference in contrast to the normal one in PLC. And in 90 degree, when the combined injuries to the PLC and PCL. But when only PLC injuries, that is, we found the difference in 30 degree, but reduced in 90 degree. Its reverse pivot shift also positive in case of lateral collateral ligament injuries. And external rotation decurvatum positive when lower leg is falls into the external rotation, and decurvatum when leg is suspended by the toes in supine patient. Classification also more or less same. That is, grade one is 0 to 5 millimeter of in varus opening, 6 to 10 millimeter of varus opening in grade two, in grade three more than 10 millimeter. In case of imaging, that is, there is also MRI is the most important things. Grade one edema surrounding the intact ligament, and grade two the intrasubstance signal, and grade three frank disruption. There is also option for non-operative treatment in grade one and grade two. We have to do the operative treatment when in combination with the other injuries in PLC. Indications in the grade three injuries and persistent pain, instability, and functional limitation despite non-operative management. There is a little role of direct repair in case of acute disruption. Repair should be done within 2 to 3 weeks. And there is more chance of failure. Reconstruction, there is different techniques. Larsen, IM, Kero, and Leprade. Most commonly used techniques are the Leprade techniques. Rehabilitation, there is a partial weight bearing with knee braces locked in extension for 6 weeks. And brace should be unlocked for range of motion exercise early, in early period, close chain quadriceps strengthening exercises, and return to the full function at 10 to 12 months. Anterolateral ligaments are discussed well in previous portions, so I'm not talking about that. Thank you all for patience hearing.
Thank you, Dr. Abdul, for sharing your view. Now we will have question answer session. So any question on hamstring graft harvesting? Dr. Sridhar? Yeah, Sridhar is there. So, Hemant sir?
What are the tricks to avoid nerve injury? What is your incidence in your practice? The numbness?
Maybe around 5 to 10% of the patients definitely will be there to be true and all, but most often they go unnoticed. Most of the patients, the practical point of view is most of the patients, they even may not notice it significantly. Some patients, they come back saying, sir, I have some numbness and all. So some patients do recover well within maybe 3 to 6 months span of time. So mostly mine, I use an oblique incision, sir. I use an oblique incision only on the skin and go blunt dissection with the finger up to the fascia.
What is the diameter you prefer for your ACLs?
Graph. Usually I prefer around 8, sir. Okay. For 8.
There is one question in question answer box, Sridhar. So sometimes the slip is of the semi-T and it goes inside the tunnel. So how do you get back in those situations?
Usually we can retrieve it back. Like if you are taking first the semi-T, usually you can trace it along the grid slip because their attachment or their path is the same thing. So you can hold it as a long artery and trace it around the grid slip. If you have taken already one tendon and the second one is the one which is lost, then you maybe have to go to the deeper dissection. But it may not be a much problem.
Thank you, Siddha. And second talk was by Dr. Chaudhary Iqbal Mahmood. So any question from my expert panel on peroneus graft harvesting? So I have one question, Dr. Chaudhary. So do you prefer this graft in athletic population also, or?
No, I usually don't prefer. I don't prefer in athletic population. In my practice, I use PL graft in 5% cases, particularly in women, fat, stocky women, or if there is any medial side injury. Other than that, I don't use peroneus longus tendon.
So Clement sir, we want to have your view on peroneus graft, because now in last 2-3 years it has come in big way. So how you use this peroneus longus graft in your practice? It's your primary graft of choice?
I use in revision scenarios. It's a very good graft, in fact. But it was nicely shown, the video demonstration, everything. Congrats, Dr. Chaudhary. And only one thing, my friend, Dr. Raghvi from Hyderabad, uses them quite a bit of them. In fact, he uses it as a primary choice for sports persons. But he says one point that you should not suture the stump with the peroneus brevis. From his point of view, he says that leads to a lot of pain and complications, and to leave it alone, you don't have to suture at all. So I don't suture the stump with the peroneus brevis. Surprisingly, I don't have any pain or any problem with that one. And the other tip, which would be to do, if you are doing PCL reconstruction with this peroneus graft, you can make additional incision on the foot around the fifth metatarsal, and you can take a longer graft as well. Otherwise, that's the only thing which I want to know. What is the panel's experience on pain when you suture peroneus along a stump with peroneus brevis? I have not been suturing. Function-wise, we are evaluated with foot and ankle surgeon. All the patients, they are doing very well. But is it really necessary, or is it leads to some problems like pain? That's what I want to ask, Rajiv.
Yeah, so I usually suture it, and in some of my patients, yes, they came with the lateral ankle pain. Maybe that be the cause, because once you suture it, you have vicaryl also, and you have a good, you have a fibrosis also the lateral part. And then I think some amount of impingement is there. So that is the cause of pain. Dr. Hassan Masood, your opinion? Please unmute. Please unmute, Dr. Hassan.
Yes, thank you, Dr. Rajiv Raman. I have also used the peroneus longus grafts in many of my patients. And my first experience is that they complain about the stump. But pain occasionally, like in 5 to 10% of cases, there is lateral pain. But stump, sometimes they, I also just fixed it with the peroneus brevis. So that stump with peroneus brevis. So they sometimes complain about stump. There is a bumping and there is a swelling there. But pain, like 5 to 10% cases.
Yes. Dr. Iqbal, you use a absorbable suture or non-absorbable suture to tie the
non-absorbable suture? I use non-absorbable suture. I don't put so many knots in the stump so that it don't become bulky. So I got some patient with ankle swelling initially, but after 1 month or 2 months, the swelling goes away. So not so many pain, some weakness in the eversion, but it will go after 6 months. So far, my experience is good with the PL tendon.
And Dr. Cleveland, to be very frank, many of our arthroscopy surgeons in Bangladesh are using this peroneus longus graft.
Yes.
A good follow-up, a long follow-up is needed to evaluate the outcome. But it is a popular graft in Bangladesh.
You have a thick graft and very easy to harvest.
Exactly.
Especially for PCL, when you need a thick graft and a long graft, I think it's one of the best graft for PCL. Because sometimes adding a semi-T and gracilis also, you don't get 9.5 diameter, desired diameter you want for PCL reconstruction. So we have lots of questions for ALL also. ALL, so Dr. Clement, there's 6 or 7 questions we will share with Dr. Clement and Dr. Yugal, both of you. The first question is for Dr. Clement Joseph, is what are your primary indication for ALL reconstruction, sir?
Anybody with a high-grade pivot shift, grade 3, grade 4, anybody wants to play sports, leisure sports, as well as high-end contact sports, and revision scenarios, almost all the cases, I do lateral procedure, and women with loose joints. So those are the patients. Women are very prone, young patients are prone for re-ruptures. So I add ALL in those cases. Yeah.
Another question is sometimes in generalized ligament. Yugal, you want to add something?
Yeah.
So these are the basic indications, and if there is a lax joints, like sir said, in women's.
So there's another question for Dr. Yugal. So sometimes in generalized ligament laxity, you get a explosive pivot also. So in those cases also, you would like to do a ALL with ACL?
So we will we can check it intraoperatively after ACL reconstruction also. If the graduate if the pivot is more, then definitely we should go ahead with it.
This is a very good point.
And also, it is important to.
Yeah, please.
Yeah, yeah. Sorry to add in. It's in cases of generalized laxity, you can always compare with the opposite knee. How there is ACL. Sometimes there could be a reverse pivot shift. If you are doing external rotation too much when you are doing your pivot shift, the reverse pivot shift, which is normal in 27% of people, can also be interpreted as an explosive pivot shift. So it's very important to compare both sides. And as you well pointed out, if you have any doubt, you just do it, fix it, and always add an AL section with this technique and the anchor, which you well has described. Because a lot of times when webinars, we see people saying that this should be a pre-op decision, but many times it's a per-op or post-op decision. So that's why we kind of modify this technique.
What are your experience and what are your, do you do ALL reconstruction routinely in explosive pivot?
Very late, sir. Very late, sir.
Yeah?
Just started recently. Very late.
Just started. Just started. And what about Dr. Hassan Masood? Yeah, Dr. Iqbal, you are...
I have two questions for Clement, sir. What is the position of tensioning the graft? Because it is seen that sometimes though we overstrain the knee. So what's the position of fixation during graft tensioning in ALL reconstruction?
I fix the graft at 30 degree with foot in neutral rotation. But in some patients who have a natural hyperextension, and you are worried that you may lose the hyperextension, probably you can take the knee to 0 degree extension and then you can fix it. Okay. So people with normal knees, 30 degree neutral rotation. People with hyperextended knee, you have doubt that you may overconstrain the knee. Probably I would fix it at about 0 degree neutral extension and neutral rotation.
Thank you, sir.
There is one question for Dr. Clement and Dr. Yugal also. So what is the minimum diameter of the gracilis or the ITP band graft you prefer for ALL reconstruction?
Yugal, you want to answer that?
Sir, around 8 mm.
8 millimeter.
8 millimeter of IT band and gracilis, you get what you get. So usually it should be around 4.5 millimeter as a single strand of gracilis. That goes into the socket and the gracilis goes into the tibia, comes back, and probably you may get around 6 to 7 millimeter thickness of gracilis, but it is a double strand.
So one question for Dr. Clement, sir, in chat box. So what is the minimum distance between the bony, minimum distance of the bony bridge in between the two tunnel, tibial tunnel for ALL reconstruction?
8 millimeters to 10 millimeter, yeah. 8 to 10 millimeters on the tibial side.
We have a few questions on ACL avulsion also for Dr. Hassan Masood. Dr. Hassan Masood, sir, there is a question that what do you prefer? What type of suture you use for this avulsion fixation? How many suture, how many loop you want for pedetic fixation? 2, 3, or 4?
I am doing with two loops.
Two side only.
Yeah, two
and side. For pediatric ACL avulsion fixation, do you cross the physis or you are doing a physial sparing surgery?
Physial sparing in most of the cases. Sometimes I have to cross the physis by suture fixation. When I use the screw, I spare the physis with oblique screws.
Sridhar, so 7, 8 years or 8 year children, sometimes we get this ACL avulsion. So do you cross the, you go for physial sparing or you go through the physis for tibial tunnel?
Usually try to do with the physial sparing.
Clement, sir, but any trick in dealing with this?
We should not compromise on the reduction. That's the main thing.
All right, yes. Clement, sir, your view?
Yeah, in adults, I prefer a suture bridge kind of fixation. Mm-hmm. In pediatric boys, there are two things we can use. We can use a smooth care wire, a long tunnel perpendicular to the physis that can be used along with short biopins. Okay. One or two biopins in different directions, which you measure and cut it maybe 2 centimeter long so that the biopins will just fix the fragment, but they won't cross the physis. So you have multiple fixation as well as one long care wire, which can be removed after some time. Yeah.
Dr. Masood, there's another question. How do you rehab this patient, and what is the, in which position you immobilize the knee?
Generally, patients are placed in a hinged knee brace, locked in 0 degree flexion for the first 4 weeks and allowed to perform just passive and active assisted range of motion in the prone position through an arc of 0 to 90 degrees. And after 4 weeks, I just remove the brace. But patient may do the weight bearing as tolerated, but the brace will be locked at 0 degree. And I usually prefer to remove the crutches after 2 weeks.
Thank you, Dr. Hasan Masood. And there's one question for Dr. Abdul Hai also on collateral injury. Sometimes there is a grade 3 MCL injury with an ACL injury. So once you have reconstructed, Sridhar, you want to make some point?
No, fine.
Yeah. So once you reconstruct your ACL, it's grade 2. So in those cases, whether you will go for MCL reconstruction or not? Collateral MCL.
I like to reconstruct the MCL in these cases.
So this is a very common thing, Clement sir, we see in our day-to-day practice. We see pre-operatively, it's almost grade 2 plus injury. But once we reconstruct our ACL, it's now grade 1 plus. So how do you decide in those cases whether to go for MCL?
It depends on the alignment also. I look at the native alignment. Yeah, it depends on the alignment and the activity demand as well. If the patient has a natural varus alignment, the MCL is not going to make much difference because we always release so much of MCL when you do osteotomy, we don't see that much. So I would like to treat these patients as conservatively as possible, especially after ACL, we see that the MCL is gone to grade 1 or 2, still I would conserve it. The only problem comes when the patient is going to be a sports person or is got a neutral or valgus alignment, then the load is going to be too much on the healing MCL. So probably if there is an acute case, probably I may do an internal bracing. I've done few cases along with some repair as well. In chronic situation, probably I'll add a thin graft like a gristless. So I give some importance to alignment as well. Do you share these views, Rajiv? How do you take alignment into consideration?
Definitely. That is the primary concern. And I think the preoperative assessment is important. This was a very good question. And if you have a grade 2 plus injury or 3 plus injury in a sports person, I think you should not be very much conservative, because and alignment is the main issue. If you're dealing with a varus knee or a valgus knee, you should plan accordingly. That is important and pertinent point also. Dr. Yugal, your view on this?
So we should reconstruct if it's a grade 3 or grade 4 injury.
So it's better if it's a grade 2 plus injury and after ACL reconstruction is 1 plus, better to go for reconstruction. I think there's some network issue with Yuga. Sridhar, how do you deal in such type of cases? ACL with 2 plus MCL?
Hello.
Yeah.
Can you hear me, sir?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Sir, it depends on if the ACL is completely torn and off. It's the same issue. after reconstruction, still if you feel there is a medial opening, definitely I'll go for fixation, reconstruction. If it's an acute one, maybe 3 weeks to 6 weeks, definitely try to repair it. If it's more than 6 weeks, definitely try for a reconstruction.
Issue, I think someone, So the last question in chat box for ACL with PLC injury. So ACL with PLC injury, Dr. Abdul. So when do you decide you will go for a Laprade type of technique, that is, or a arterio type of technique where you or you, when you will plan whether you will go for a TBR based approach or a fibula based approach for posterolateral cornea reconstruction? Dr. Abdul?
Yes, I used to the modified Laprade technique.
Always, yeah.
Yeah.
Dr. Yugal, your point on this, whether to go for the TBR based posterolateral cornea reconstruction or a TBR and fibula based posterior PLC reconstruction, how do you decide in PLC injury?
TBR and fibula based, both.
Both. In all cases, it's like in all cases, you go for a Laprade, classical Laprade or modified Laprade type of thing.
Yes.
Clement sir, the posterolateral cornea is very dark corner of knee, and
see, the Laprade is a very extensive surgery, okay, and in my opinion it's very useful only when the tibio fibular joint is unstable, okay, so where you can't do any fibular based reconstructions. Otherwise, in most of the cases, you can get away with a Larsen or a arterio modification of Larsen technique. Yeah, probably I would go for Laprade in very gross lesions. The knee is opening grossly. Those are the indications. But a minor grade 2 injuries where there's not much opening, probably a fibula, I'll go for examination of tibio fibular joint. If it is stable, we can as well do a fibula based approach.
Dr. Hassan Masood, so PLC reconstruction.
Yes, I am in accordance with Dr. Clement sir. I mean, same opinion.
Dr. Chaudhary, yeah.
I do most of the cases fibular based reconstruction, but very rarely Laprade technique in my cases.
So if you have a gross instability, I think the dial test is excessive. You are getting explosive dial test. I think in those cases, TBL based reconstruction is quite good. But for type AB or grade 1-2 type of PLC injury, you can just come out with the arterio or a Larsen technique also. Yeah, that's a good. Sridhar, what do you prefer in your clinical practice? Yes?
Mostly modified like that.
So modified leopard. That was the last question, and I would like to have two votes of thanks, one from Bangladesh part, Dr. Hassan Masood at Kenta Charge, and one from Indian side, Dr. Clement Joseph sir. So first from Bangladesh, Dr. Hassan Masood.
Thank you, Dr. Rajiv Dha, for a nice academic gathering, and thanks Biotech to arrange this type of webinar, and I would like that in the future we'll be meeting together to exchange our views. And thanks Clement sir and other Indian participants and my Bangladeshi colleagues. And especially thanks to Rajiv Dha for moderating nicely. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Clement sir.
Yeah, Indian side, very glad this is a new experience for us. And also to learn from you techniques, wonderful videos you have shown. And it's very nice to be part of this meeting. I hope to see your Bangladesh collaboration opportunities much more in the future. And thanks, Rajiv, for a very nice talk from you, as well as a nice moderation. Well done. And Sridhar, always a very active young gentleman from India, Yugal, always me. And from the Bangladeshi counterparts, Sir Asim Mohammed, Sir Mazur, Sir Chaudhary, Sir, and Abdul Hai. Wonderful lectures from you. Thanks, Biotech, for this wonderful opportunity of collaboration. I hope to continue this with Biotech help in future, like shoulder and other things. Thank you very much from my side.
Yes, sir. Final word from Team Biotech, please. Yes,
sir. On behalf of Biotech, I would like to thank you all for this wonderful, wonderful webinar and for your precious time. And it is our great privilege and honor to have you all in one platform. So at the end, I would say stay safe. And good night to all. Rajesh sir, by your permission,
we can stop live here. And thank you everyone for participating. It was a wonderful meeting. Let's hope we will meet in future. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Good night.
Stay safe.
Good night. Good night.